Imagine spending an hour with the world's greatest traders. Imagine learning from their experiences, their successes, and their failures. Imagine no more. Welcome to Top Traders Unplugged, the place where you can learn from the best hedge fund managers in the world so you can take your manager, due diligence, or investment career to the next level. Before we begin today's conversation, remember to keep two things in mind. All the discussion we'll have about investment performance is about the past, and past performance does not guarantee or even infer anything about future performance. Also understand that there's a significant risk of financial loss with all investment strategies, and you need to request and understand the specific risks from the investment manager about their product before you make investment decisions. Here's your host, veteran hedge fund manager, Niels Kastrup Larsen.
On today's show, I'm talking to Mike Dever, the founder and CEO of Brandywine Asset Management. Mike's been trading for almost four decades and shares a wealth of insight to how he has stayed successful and how his trading approach and research has stayed current in an ever-changing financial landscape. For those of you who are new to the show, I just want to let you know that you can find all of the show notes, including a full transcript of today's episode, on the toptradersunplugged.com website. Now let's get started with part one of my conversation. I hope you will enjoy it. Mike, before we jump into more of the specific topics and questions that we will cover today, I just want to start out by acknowledging you and thank you for being on the podcast today. I still remember when I visited your offices, you know, about 17 years ago, because it left such an impression on me and because of its uniqueness. So of course, I'm interested to hear whether your offices are still located in this wonderful 17th century gristmill that you renovated so beautifully.
They are. We're now going on close to 20 years in here.
Fantastic. And speaking on uniqueness, I think it's fair to say that you do things a little bit different to many of the other systematic investment managers. And this will certainly shine through our talk today. So I think our audience is in for a real treat, and I think we should just jump right into to today's topics, if that's okay with you.
Excellent. Thank you.
Mike, your journey has been long and distinguished, spanning over nearly 40 years of trading, as well as being a best-selling author of the book Jackass Investing, and not forgetting an internet pioneer. And it's my impression that these different experiences play an important role in what you do today from a trading point of view. So perhaps you could take us back to the beginning and tell us this fascinating story and of course a bit of background on Brandywine as a firm and its evolution over the years.
Certainly. Yeah, I founded Brandywine in 1982, and I had been trading for a few years prior to that, just myself on a discretionary basis. And throughout the 1980s, traded, continuing to do more of a discretionary trading, but with some support from computers and other research to kind of position my trades. The other thing that was, I think, key to me, and it was just a nice experience through the 80s, was that I had started some funds with some other managers as well. One of the early ones that I came in contact with, I sought him out, actually, was Dick Donchian, who a lot of people acknowledge, I guess, is the grandfather of trend following trading.
Absolutely.
Yeah, he was at Shearson at the time, and I went up and met with Dick and started putting a fund together that Dick would manage. I would be the pool operator. He'd be the CTA on it. And we got well down that path before Shearson put an end to that. They didn't want, you know, some young punk, me, you know, running a fund with one of their brokers on it. So, unfortunately, we weren't able to put that together. But my hope was to complement my own trading with funds that would be managed by some other traders, and really more of it was from a business standpoint to help smooth out the revenues to the firm. So I did end up in 1984 meeting another trader by the name of Paul Tudor Jones, and I allocated some capital to him. I had met in 82 John Henry and allocated some capital to him. So I did have a couple other funds that were out there managed by some other managers. And so it was a nice experience through the 80s with my own trading, the research I continued to do, the sort of ability to be, you know, on the front of the stage with some of the early pioneers in the hedge fund industry with Paul and with John. And I carried that into the 1990s as well, when I set up a fund and we were the first outside investor for TransTrend on a fund that they launched when they launched their company in 1992.
Wow. Yeah, I didn't realize that. Wow.
Yeah, so it's been, you know, kind of a nice experience in seeing what some of these other people are doing as well. And what I did through the 80s, I started realizing with the discretionary trading, which was round the clock, that I really, in order to get more predictable performance instead of what I refer to as the ultimate black box, which is, you know, a brain, and not really knowing day to day exactly, you know, how that brain was going to react to certain market conditions and environments, I really wanted to systematize the approach. So we sat down in the late 80s, put together a research project that over the next few years became rather intensive and extensive, and developed a systematic trading model that was very different at the time. And even today, I look at it and I realize that there's so many things we did then, which is 25 years ago now, that people still are not doing today, and I believe give us a real nice edge. But we systematized the approaches, and we launched our Brandywine Benchmark program in 1991.
Yeah. And would you say even at that time you were, you know, influenced by what you'd seen from these great traders that you were allocating money to?
It was nice having that experience and exposure, but, you know, what I realized was that they were doing things very differently than the way I thought of doing things.
Okay.
You know, as Paul Jones was, you know, very much a discretionary trader. And as often as he tried to systematize his approaches, I don't think he could quite capture what it was that he was doing on a discretionary basis. He had just such a, and still has, I think, an innate intuition, you know, for markets. And above all else, he just had an enormous discipline for being able to manage risk in his portfolio. You know, John, obviously, John Henry was one of the early pioneers in trend following, and it's a fairly straightforward approach. It's a sound return driver, but it is only one return driver. You know, so I could pretty much have a good idea what his positions were without even looking at my brokerage statements.
Sure.
and TransTrend, you know, I came into contact with TransTrend when I was doing the research for our benchmark program, and realized that they also were involved in the belief of the broad strategy in market diversification. Now, we take it a little bit differently than they do. They tend to be, I believe, more technical. I don't know today exactly what they do, but, you know, at that time, and we have more fundamental basis strategies in our portfolio. But we still shared that philosophy that essentially there is a free lunch, and that's portfolio diversification.
And the benchmark program, was that systematic and completely without discretion, or did you keep some of the sort of your discretionary trading in there?
No, we didn't. It was fully systematic. But what we did was look at a lot of the types of trading that I did through the 80s and try to capture that in a systematic fashion. So, for example, we had, you know, a number of strategies that were based on market reaction to news events or reports, because I traded a lot of that type of event reaction. Sure. In my Sure. discretionary trading. So we systematized the approach, captured it in the best way we possibly could, and included that in the benchmark program. So there were a number of strategies in benchmark that were based on sort of that intuitive or discretionary feel, but instead of relying on you know, the black box of the brain to interpret everything correctly each day, it followed, you know, rigid set of rules to be able to repeat the process, you know, every time it recurred.
And so in that sense, just to be clear, were you convinced even at that time early on that if you were going to be successful from an investment management point of view, you had to be systematic? Was that something that just was obvious at that time, or Or was it more an operational issue where you say, okay, what's actually easier if I can do it systematically? Because, you know, the systematic side of things are partly, I think, an operational issue, but it's also an emotional issue.
I mean, the one thing you get that you get from systematic, I mean, you get a lot of things, but the one main thing that I think would benefit the majority of traders out there is the discipline that it brings to the trading.
Yeah.
It's, you can sit there and say as much as you want as a discretionary trader, well, I'm gonna cut my losses at these levels. I've got a bad trade. I'm gonna get out when it does this. But not everybody does that, and you may do that for a while, but at some point, there's that constant battle where you're sitting there saying, but it's a great position. I've got a great position, and you know, I've been reading some books about the financial crisis, and one of the things that you see there that's the same as what you had with long-term capital is that just that utter breakdown in risk management discipline. And it's easy for a person to sit and rationalize why, you know what, the risk management wasn't designed for this scenario, or this was a great trade, you know, 10% loss ago. It's even better now,
yeah.
You know, so I'm certainly not going to get out of it today and just ride it into the ground. So the one thing, if there's nothing else that you get from systematic trading, is the disciplined risk management approach to trading.
Sure. No, absolutely. And so the Brandywine Benchmark Program, that ran until 1998, I think. Tell me a little bit about sort of your experience during that time, and then you moved on to other things, as I remember.
Sure. Yeah, so Benchmark was, when we went out with Benchmark Program, it was really interesting because we funded it with $1 million in 1991. And we had a lot of confidence that what we were going to get performance-wise was going to be fairly similar to what we tested it to perform it like. And
sure.
the reason was because of the methodologies that we developed, not only in our backtesting of the trading strategies, but in the portfolio allocation model. And I'll talk about that for a second.
Sure.
When we went out in the late 1980s, knowing that we were going to have dozens of trading strategies, we're going to be trading across dozens of eventually over 100 markets in the portfolio, the first thing we needed to know was how we're going to allocate across those strategies and markets in the portfolio. And so we went out and we looked at some of the standard, conventional, accepted, I guess, methods for portfolio modeling, such as mean variance modeling, the Markowitz type modeling, and that everybody was doing, looking at fishing frontier analysis. And we hired some of the brightest people out there to help us create portfolios based on those methodologies. And one of the first results I got back from one of those researchers was the results of how to allocate across. It was about 15 different strategies, maybe 30 different markets. And the results came back with a high concentration of one of the strategies trading in one of those markets, a few other strategy market combinations, and then pretty much else everything was a null set. There were no allocations. So when I called him on that, I said, okay, obviously these results aren't right. I can't do this. You know, it's not going to work going forward. His response to me was, that's the perfect answer. And I started realizing that what they considered perfect was a mathematical elegance, you know, a level of mathematical perfection that had nothing at all to do with what I was trying to accomplish, which was to create a trading program where I could look at its back-tested performance and have a high level of confidence that that was going to occur again in the future.
Yeah.
So I sat down for the next 6 months to a year, and we had a number of people working on this, but it ended up really coming down to more of an intuitive result. And what I realized was that the question that was being asked by everybody that was doing portfolio modeling then and continuing to today was wrong. They were asking, how do we achieve the most optimal performance?
Yeah.
And they got that. But the question was that they should have been asking was, how do I get the most predictable performance?
Yeah.
Nothing else matters. If you've got optimal returns that you don't know are predictable going into the future, who cares?
Sure.
And so what you found was that people were fixing their results. They would get answers back, the perfect result like I got from my one researcher, and then they would modify it. They would say, well, we won't allocate more than 5% to any strategy market combination, or we'll add a little bit of these other things, even though they don't really get much of an allocation because we know they diversify the portfolio and they add value. My response to that has always been, if you get results back that you know are wrong, don't tweak the results. That's the same as putting earrings on a pig. You know, what you've got to do is go back and fix the original model.
Yeah.
And so that's when we came up with the predictive diversification portfolio allocation model, and we use it to today.
Yeah. Yeah, no, we're certainly going to talk a lot more about that. But just briefly, Mike, if you would just take us through the next iteration of your career after 1998. Because I think also maybe that's, you know, partly influencing, you know, when you returned to managing money a few years ago.
Yeah, definitely. In 1996, end of 1996, I started a company called Spree.com. Spree was a early pioneer in e-commerce, and we really referred to it as an e-commerce community, because Spree allowed people to come in and set up their own storefronts, sell products off of those storefronts. Spree managed all the back end of that for them, and pretty quickly, by mid-98, Spree had grown to being the seventh most trafficked e-commerce company in the world.
Wow.
So it became a bit of a tail wagging the dog, where I thought Spree was going to be a side project. When I launched Spree, I had a couple dozen employees in Brandywine. By mid-98, late 98, we had over 80 employees in Spree.
Yeah.
So it now was three times as big as Brandywine was. And we started getting acquisition interest from a number of companies that were looking at buying Spree. And so I really ended up focusing a lot of my attention on Spree. I brought in some additional other people to manage Brandywine. And it really was a great experience and a sad experience at the same time, because Brandywine is and still is my first love and my first primary interest. And I was not able to stay running that at the same time that I was trying to, you know, hitch a ride on the Spree. I mean, it was a sure. roller coaster. It was crazy.
Sure.
So I needed to be there on the Spree side. And I guess I overestimated the amount of sort of corporate continuity and corporate memory there would be with me stepping away from Brandywine, because it radically changed over the next 2 years. And the research group that I had put in place was replaced by a researcher doing equity research, another one doing futures research, because we had some equity programs as well. And it became more of a conventional type firm in the way it did its research.
Okay.
And so Spree was a great company, a great experience. And I got out of Spree at the end of 1999, early 2000, when we had venture capital money come in. I set up a company called Mind Drivers, which was essentially taking on the other early stage technology businesses that had grown up around Spree. And I ran that through the 2000s. And in 2007, sold one of those companies and started the path back to doing investments, you know, liquid investment trading again. So really, there was about almost a decade period where I still had a foot in the door with the trading side, but it wasn't the immersive experience that it had prior to that or subsequent to that.
Sure. And just out of curiosity, I mean, did you, for your own part, did you continue sort of any systematic trading during these years, or did you simply walk away from trading while you were doing the internet side?
We had a mix. We had one fund that when I got back into Brandywine, we were managing, that was our largest product at the time. The futures trading had essentially dissolved at that time, and
sure.
That's really my fault. I had promoted Brandywine as being a benign dictatorship, and when they saw that, I stepped away. Our investors stepped away as well. So that was a bit of the corporate continuity issue that I had with that. We've resolved today by bringing in a partner and doing some other things. But I had one fund at that point that was doing mutual fund arbitrage, and we continued to trade that for a few years and then expanded on that by running another fund that was trading that, as well as the venture capital early stage investing deals I was involved in. And that product in 2004 added some futures in a sub account that traded for about 2 years.
Okay.
But we realized that unless we were going to be fully committed and focused on one type of trading,
sure,
yeah, it didn't make sense. So we refocused that fund entirely on venture capital, and that actually remains open today as a venture capital product. But today, when we got back into trading, everything we're doing now is fully focused on our globally diversified liquid assets trading.
Yes, and of course, 2011 comes, and in July you launch your current program, the Symphony program.
Yes. Yeah. So Symphony, what was interesting about this process is when I made the decision to get back into trading on a full-time basis and commit to, you know, beginning the Symphony, Brandywine Symphony program, I went back to the strategies that we had developed in the 90s, and there were about maybe three dozen that were in the benchmark program, and pulled out, you know, evaluated all the ones, pulled out the ones that I thought were still relevant today. There were some that became irrelevant. Ones, for example, we had that was looking at freely traded interest rates, Fed controlled versus freely traded. That in the 2009-10 period when we were starting to redevelop the program, we realized there just wasn't the environment for that.
Sure.
You didn't have that freedom of interest rates in the environment. So there were strategies like that that we didn't even look at updating the testing on. But there were about two dozen that still remain relevant today, and we updated the testing on those. And the great news about it, and I like to say it's, you know, the good and the bad, and the, you know, the good side and the great news was that those strategies continued to perform as expected from 1999 through the 2009 period when we first started updating the walk forward on those, as we had not only back tested them to perform through the 70s and the 80s,
sure,
but they actually performed with real money in the 1990s. So the strategies remain valid. The bad news, as I like to point out, is if I had just simply continued to run Brandywine in that fashion, I would have owned a baseball team today.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, so I don't have the Boston Red Sox, but I, you know, do have those strategies and they're of enormous value. So yeah, we went out, we raised $10 million to have non-proprietary capital trading the initial seed account, started trading that in July of 2011, which was coincident with the publishing of my book, Jackass Investing.
Yeah, yeah. And today, can people come to you both through managed accounts and fund vehicles, or how does it, how do people come to you today?
Yeah, so either way. So a managed account is a $5 million nominal account size minimum. If somebody, and that's targeting about an 8% annualized standard deviation with a low double-digit return. So if somebody wants to take a $5 million account and is willing to accept higher, you know, volatility or risk in their portfolio, they could notionally fund it.
Sure.
And, you know, we could have as little as maybe one-third cash,
yeah,
to the $5 million investment. Then we also have two funds. One is our standard Brandywine Symphony fund that trades at the standard 8% annualized standard deviation leverage. And then we have what we would refer to as a cash efficient product, which is essentially the same as notionally funding a managed account that trades at 3x that standard leverage. And that's,
sure,
our Brandywine Symphony preferred fund. And those are able to be invested in at $100,000 minimums.
Great. And how much does the program run or manage in total today?
$30 million today.
Okay, great. Mike, I want to shift gear a little bit on you and just, touch upon a little bit about the organization, because you, as well as I think many other firms, I think you run a very lean infrastructure today. And I guess a lot of that is based on all the wonderful things we can do today with technology. But how do you view sort of what to keep internally in the firm, in our business, and what can be outsourced? How have you balanced those two things?
Yeah, there's two reasons that Brandywine today can be a lot smaller personnel-wise than it was in the 1990s. The one is what you're pointing out is there's so much good technology now available to do a lot of the same things that we did with people in the past.
Yeah.
The second is that Brandywine already had such a great base,
yeah,
of research that we could pull on. And so we were able to probably get, you know, the same effect as far as diversification portfolio and the research with one-fifth, one-tenth of the people that we,
yeah,
had in the research,
yeah,
group back then. Yeah. On the things that we can outsource today, and in the 1990s, we built our own front-to-back research, trading, account reconciliation, account management program. Today, we have what we call Cadence, which is our trading research and order generation system. And then we have, now we've outsourced, well, not outsourced, but we licensed DMAX, the books, to do all the account management side.
Okay.
And then you can go through, for example, CQG or PAT system or trading technology to do trade execution. So you don't have the same need for the staffing of the trading desk that you had in the past as well. So we're able to operate with four full-times and some part-time people today. And I think we can, you know, maintain pretty lean operation, you know, growing as over the next year or two.
Yeah, yeah. And in terms of growth and so on and so forth, looking at the markets and the way you trade the markets, is there anything to be said about an optimal size for the program? Is there anything where you would say, you know, we've designed it to be X amount under management and probably not further than that? Or,
well, there are certainly markets that we trade in the portfolio today that have lower liquidity than others, such as we trade the livestock markets, some of the other foodstuffs, agriculturals that have lower liquidity in them. The way we look at it is at what asset levels will we be able to maintain, say, 100% optimal diversification, and how will that change as assets increase? And, you know, roughly, because we're so broadly diversified across trading strategies and markets in the portfolio, we can probably get close to that $500 million, $3 billion range before we start allocating suboptimally to the markets in the portfolio. And then what will happen is, you know, that next tier going from $500 million to, say, $2 billion, we may drop from being 100% optimally allocated to 80% optimally allocated in the portfolio. And then it tends to sort of level off a bit after that, because it drops a little, but for the most part, the markets that you remain able to be optimally allocated to, they're very liquid, so you can go up into the billions quite easily. And you just continue to maintain the same position sizes, maximal position sizes in those less liquid markets, which lowers their effect on the portfolio as your AUM grows. But, you know, we believe that, you know, for the first $500 million or so, we're pretty good and able to be reasonably optimally allocated. But that's really a function of the fact that we've got so many strategies and markets in the portfolio. If we were trading a narrower portfolio, you know, we'd hit that threshold much sooner.
Sure, absolutely. Now, another area that I want to cover and talk a little bit about is sort of just track record from a very high level. I mean, the Symphony program, in my opinion, has a great track record. I mean, starting in 2011 has certainly been an interesting time to launch a program. And, you know, I've obviously seen your numbers and they look great. So obviously I invite people to look more into that. But I want to ask you, with such a long experience in this industry, and that's just really performance after 2009 in the CTA space has in many respects been quite different to performance prior to 2009. And I mean, of course, you're probably one of very few in terms of the exception to this, because your performance has been pretty strong in the last few years, while many large managers who've been around for, you know, two or three decades have had you know, somewhat more of a challenge, and even some of them, you know, seeing their drawdowns, you know, expand quite dramatically. What's your sense and what's your two pennies about, you know, performance in the last few years compared to, you know, the much longer period that sort of CTAs and trend following in particular has been known for being quite a robust investment case?
Right. So I can certainly talk in, you know, reasonable detail on what we do, to the extent that we want to reveal things. But I can only surmise what might be going on in the rest of the people that are out there, you know, registered as CTAs. And, you know, with Brandywine, our approach is return driver based. So we're looking at sound, logical return drivers that we can build trading strategies on and then diversify across those in a portfolio. So we don't really limit ourselves at all to any style of trading. You know, if we think there's opportunity in trading against investor sentiment in the S&P, we'll develop strategies that capture that. If we think there's things that I can do, like the event trading I did as a discretionary trader in the 1980s, we'll develop strategies based on return drivers that will do that. So we've got now dozens of different return drivers that are underlying the straight trading strategies in our portfolio. So we end up with returns coming from a lot of different sources. And, you know, that from our standpoint means that we kind of don't care about any specific environment that's out there. You know, for us, it's the last 3 years are the same as the prior 3 years. Contrary to that, I think what I've seen happen, and it's not just the guys that are out there and the women that are registered as CTAs. This is the investment industry in general, is that people tend to latch on to a certain style that was successful, and they fine-tune maybe a little too much their approach to being suited to that style. And when the markets change, the environment changes a little bit, that style falls out of favor, they lose money. So the example we've had in the futures industry, if you can call it an industry, and I really kind of don't refer to it so much as an industry because everybody's independent, but there is a group of people that trade futures markets using trend following strategies, because that was one of the return drivers that they looked at and said, wow, you know, over the last couple decades, this makes money. And no different than equity managers who sit there and say, wow, this value thing makes money. I'm going to be a value investor. It's just one return driver. I mean, there's dozens more that they can employ. So they start out by limiting themselves to one return driver, and then they compound the problem, from what I've seen, by fine-tuning that return driver to give them the best possible performance on that past data. And we don't have any return drivers that, when it's properly constructed into a trading strategy, consistently make money over multiple year time frames. They may make money over 50 years, but in any decade period, almost, I would say, any trading strategy that we have has decade-long periods where it loses money. And the only way that you can avoid that in backtesting is to fine-tune the parameters till you get to a point where you don't have those periods. I just read an article. It was interesting but troubling this past week. And somebody was talking about – this is somebody that's written a lot of articles in different – magazines about trading strategies and strategy development. It was talking about a strategy that they thought was really good, but over a four-year period, it had 1 year where it lost money the entire year, and it gave up as much as 20% of the overall profits it made over that four-year period. So obviously, nobody could actually trade that in real time. And I'm looking at that going, that's just unbelievable. I don't have any strategy that is that good in my portfolio.
Sure.
And so I think what happened is, Brandywine, everything we do, everything in our research is focused on predictability of performance first and foremost. If you don't meet that threshold that you have a high degree of likelihood that the future performance is going to match the past performance, even if it's bad, I don't care. I just need the predictability first and foremost.
Yeah.
Then we can sit down and figure out how to combine those things into a portfolio, whether they should be included in a portfolio or not. The rest of the industry, every article I've read, every person I've talked to, other CTAs, equity managers, I mean, it's across the board, and academics, across the board, it's trying to find some sort of optimal performance on a trading strategy or an idea. And then the question is, okay, I know it's perfect here and it won't happen in the future. And they come up with some sort of a formula for how much they'll discount those returns and haircut the performance of that. And again, it's back to putting earrings on a pig.
Sure.
If you get results that you look at and you know they're wrong, and you've got to haircut them to tell you what you think you're going to get going forward, don't even try.
Yeah.
Start over at the beginning again. Create something that's predictable. And don't fool yourself. You're going to develop strategies, and they're going to have 10-year losing periods. Doesn't mean that the return driver's not valid.
Sure.
It just means that that's what happens.
Yeah. Well, I mean, and in a sense, it's just like looking at the equity markets. They can certainly go 10 years without making any money. It doesn't mean that people don't like investing in equities. So
that's right. And what I talk about in the book, in my first chapter, is that's because in short periods, less than 20 years in the U.S. equity markets, and I think you could apply this globally too, but I did all my research on U.S. equity markets. The dominant return driver is investor sentiment. It has nothing to do with the fundamentals of the underlying companies. So that means that you could have a company that doubles its earnings over a 10-year period, but if investor sentiment turns negative over that period, you could have a decline in that stock price or the overall index. So essentially, you're saying that those returns are dominated by a single return driver, which is investor sentiment. And if you've got a single return driver driving your returns, you're going to have decade-long periods where it doesn't perform.
Sure.
That's just what happens. And you can fix it. You can add some filters and, you know, fine tune the parameters to make it look like you wouldn't have lost money had you done those things. But now you've just slashed the predictability of performance. So the results you're looking at historically have virtually no meaning going forward.
Yeah. And I think this is also what I alluded to in the beginning, where I said that I think it's fair to say that you do things differently, and I really appreciate that. So I want to talk about, if my understanding is correct, I mean, you kind of have these sort of five, I don't know whether you define them as return drivers, but you certainly have these five themes in the model or in the program: fundamental, sentiment, event, arbitrage, and alpha hedge. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, why these, and then we're going to dive into maybe each one of them and try and get people to understand what you mean by it.
Okay, I'll start out by saying those are totally arbitrary classifications that we came up with.
Okay.
You know, so, you'll understand a little bit as we describe them more, but we have in the portfolio dozens of individual return drivers. And for purposes of illustration or discussion with investors, we categorize those into those five strategy types.
Sure.
And because they have certain characteristics that are similar, but within each of those strategy types, the trading strategies, with the exception of Alpha Hedge, have no relationship to each other as far as performance. So the return streams are totally uncorrelated, but they're based on something similar. So the idea is not so much, we don't really allocate based on those strategy types. We allocate based on each of the underlying return drivers in the portfolio.
Sure.
I can talk about different types, but you know, out of the
Give us an example of a return driver, and let's take it from there and sure. See where it goes.
Okay. Well, we talked about sentiment, and sentiment being the dominant return driver for stock market in periods of less than 20 years. Over 20 years, you start getting a bigger contribution from actual corporate earnings growth as the dominant return driver. But it's really not until you're out in the mid-20s, 30-year period, where that really starts dominating the portfolio and sentiment takes a back seat. So if you look at it and you say that sentiment is a dominant return driver for equities in the short term, you can develop trading strategies based on that return driver, that concept. And so one of the things that we do, and I actually reveal an actual trading strategy on the website, companion website for my book, and it's a sentiment-based strategy that we developed more recently because it wasn't even available to be developed in the 90s, that's looking at money flows in and out of the aggressive and inverse U.S. equity and U.S. bond now. We've extended that ETFs.
Okay.
So if you see a lot of money flowing into the triple leverage long and out of the double leverage short U.S. equity ETFs, the sentiment, it's telling you that the sentiment, people are voting with their money, the sentiment is getting bullish. Mm-hmm. And this strategy goes in and looks for extremes in that to short the market. And so it'll be very selective. It might, you know, make a few trades per year based on this approach in any given market. And those positions will be held for a week, maybe a couple weeks at the most, really just until that return drivers, which is the excess sentiment, is wrung out of the market. So we're not looking for a trend to develop or anything. We're just saying we're purely doing everything we can to as purely as possible capture that return driver.
But and if we take that as an example, so you see that obviously cash is going towards, you know, equity ETFs or whatever it might be, but how do you then implement a model? I mean, you're now looking to go short that market, but what kind of indicators do you then use in order to trigger that? Because this is a sentiment. It means cash is going in one direction, but it doesn't obviously necessarily link directly to the price of whatever underlying instrument you want to trade.
Right. But remember, what we're trying to do is, in as pure a way possible, capture that return driver. So we could change the strategy, and instead of simply shorting it when the return driver indicates, which is what we do, mm-hmm. we could say, you know, we're going to wait until the market actually breaks down. We're going to wait until there's a key reversal day.
Right.
We could wait for some other technical indicator. What we've just done by doing that is turned it a little more now into being, say, a trend strategy. You know, we're waiting for the short-term trend to turn, you know, before we do something. And we're not now purely capturing the return driver. We're
right.
capturing a combination of return drivers. So this is where I talk about predictability of performance. We have a high level of confidence that by keeping the degrees of freedom as small as possible and having that focus just on that single return driver, which is market sentiment, defined in this case by ETF money flows, that what the results we're getting historically have a high degree of probability they're going to recur in the future.
Sure.
And so that's all we care about. And then we look at those returns, those historical returns, and we say, okay, are we comfortable with those? And comfortable doesn't mean that they're great returns. It just means that, yeah, it looks like it captures some positive money over time. And it may be that in a five-year period, it made money, but it had drawdowns that were twice as big as money it made. Mm-hmm. I don't care.
Sure.
You know, it's a valid concept that's producing positive returns. And there will be periods we know that it'll go for 5 years, it'll go for 10 years, and it won't make money. As long as the concept is still valid, it's included in our portfolio.
Interesting. And before we talk about sort of overall how many return drivers and combinations and so on and so forth, do you have a sort of a similar example, again, without giving away any details you're not comfortable with, but say a fundamental strategy, what might that be?
Sure. Okay. So if you look at your trend followers, a lot of guys will, you know, a lot of these CTAs will have trend following strategies that'll be short markets and see those markets trading down to really low levels. And instinctually, maybe intuitively, they're sitting there going, "Whoa, you know, I don't really want to be short, you know, Nat gas at 250. I don't want to be short orange juice at 60 cents. But they remain short. That's what trend following does. And I don't disagree with that. I think that's – if the valid strategy is to remain short because the trend is short, you stay with it. But at the same time, that unease is pointing out something else, that there's a fundamental bias that may start providing some support at certain levels in certain markets. So in the 1990s, we developed a strategy referred to as marginal cost of production. It's looking at commodity markets that have reasonably stable commodity or marginal cost of production that can be determined. And when those markets are nearing, approaching, going under that marginal cost of production, we trade them from the long side only.
Okay.
Now, it doesn't mean that the portfolio might not be short from other strategies, but sure, that particular strategy is only going long, and it's taking short-term long-only trades in markets that sell off like that. And it may accumulate multiple positions. It may exit some of those positions. And really, the effect of it is that over an average campaign, which lasts maybe 6 months for one of these strategies, it will be in and out of the market a dozen or more times. The average trade length is around 10 days. So it'll buy, it'll sell, it'll buy some more, it'll buy some more, it'll sell some more. And, you know, each of those trades is a week or two in length, and the whole campaign of multiple trades might last 6 months. It's a infrequent strategy. There's times when markets are trading near their marginal cost production. There's periods like the late 2000s where markets were substantially above their marginal cost production and nothing happened. Our latest trade in this was in Nat Gas in January of 2012. We started putting some positions on. We got out of that a little bit and got back in. I think it was March or April. For the next few months, we're trading from the long side only as Nat Gas dropped from under $3 to under $2.
Yeah.
And, you know, then as it finally rallied back out of that range, that strategy stopped trading. We were out of it, you know, picked up maybe 50 basis points on the portfolio from that strategy over that campaign period.
Sure. And do you have an example of the an event-based strategy?
Yeah, so if event strategies, they can be – I've seen people trying to do event strategies in the past, and they were very complex. And when I traded in the 1980s, I was looking at a lot of things going into, say – well, when I started trading, it was 1979. And 79 into the early 80s, the M1 money supply was the report that people focused on.
Sure.
It really moved the markets. When you got into the 80s a little more, the trade balance became a big number, and everybody's looking at that. And what I would look at was, okay, what are the expectations for the trade number? What are the markets doing going into it? How did the markets react after, you know, immediately following it, then through the rest of the day? And I'd start coming up with, you know, trade decisions based on that sort of plethora of information. When we started systematizing the approaches, we're always trying to break it down to what is the key return driver we're trying to capture. And we've come up with some pretty nice, elegant little strategies that are looking at markets action and reaction to these reports to come up with trade decisions. So, you know, one that we had last year, I remember it was one where we bought deferred Eurodollar contracts. I think I talked about this in our monthly report based on the employment report. And we held that trade for a little over a month. And it turned out it would be just perfectly timed counter trend trade, which is often what can happen with these event strategies. You'll have at that point, a downtrend going in the Eurodollar contract, and the employment report came out, and that pretty much marked the low for, well, I think still to today in that contract, the deferred contract. So it's looking at the market reaction to those events for telling you how essentially you could classify this as a sentiment strategy, because it's telling you how the short-term sentiment has shifted based on that report release.
I have two questions on this topic. One is, this is the trigger to get into a trade, but how do you get out? What tends to trigger your exit for a trade like this?
Yeah, so each strategy has its own entry and exit triggers. And often what we're trying to do is we're trying to capture the returns from a specific return driver. Yeah. You know, so sometimes there's a tail on it. Sometimes there's market action that indicates that influence is over. You know, sometimes there's a subsequent report or something that'll trigger that difference. You know, so in the case of the first one we talked about with sentiment strategies, we're really just trying to capture that extreme in sentiment. When that's wrung out of the market, we want to be out. Yeah. You know, so you'll see that the money flows and the buys going on, and at some point that kind of comes back again and it subsides. You know, that overall sentiment enthusiasm that you had for being bullish on stocks. And when that subsides, we're out. The market might still be selling off, you know, and it might sell off for another month, 2 months, a year. We don't care, because the return driver we were capturing there was purely sentiment. We want to capture that in as pure fashion as possible.
The other question I had was really more relating to the event strategy. Do you find in today's world, where news get around much quicker and more people have access compared to, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago when you came up with some of these ideas, have some of these strategies changed their effectiveness, or do you find that they actually work just as well today as they did, when you first started using them?
Right. Well, first of all, I had the exact same questions 20 years ago. You know, information is moving much more rapidly today. People are able to process things and get information more quickly. Because if you look at the 1990s, 1990, for example, to 1970, the exact same scenario that you have today, looking, you know, the 2010s to 1990. You know, it's continued. We haven't had, since I've been involved in trading, a period where you've had slower information flow. Sure. It's always been increasing.
Yeah.
So what we find is that, you know, as I mentioned, in the early 1980s, late 1970s, you had M1 money supply is like the key indicator. Well, the way we develop a model isn't to say, okay, specifically this happens. It's looking to determine first and foremost, I guess, whether or not that indicator is still valid. So today I could incorporate event strategies using M1 money supply, and I can virtually guarantee you there would be no trading in them, even though it's the same strategy that we're using for employment report, which is it's been fairly active the last few years. Another strategy we do have in there is looking at CPI.
Okay.
I don't think the CPI strategy has made one trade since we relaunched Brandywine Symphony Trading in July 2011. Sure. So the strategy, the concept, the concept is still valid, and it can be incorporated in the portfolio and included in the portfolio. It doesn't mean that it'll remain active. It's valid, but it may not be active.
Sure.
And that's up to the strategy to determine whether or not, you know, it should be. Just same case with the ETF money flows. You know, we could plug that in there, but if it starts turning out that they're no longer a good measure of sentiment, an indication of sentiment, the strategy will stop making trading decisions based on that information.
Yeah. You also have a theme called directional arbitrage strategy. How does that fit into this?
Yeah, so directional arbitrage is using what would be considered arbitrage techniques to take directional trades in markets. So we're not actually specifically arbitraging between, well, there are some opportunities there, but in directional arbitrage, where we're not specifically going after, say, an arbitrage between one market or to another market, but we may be taking a directional position in one market based on some price action in another market.
Okay.
If you look at it sort of a specific sense, you know, with people using the carry trade and the currency markets, so that's a form of an arbitrage that gives you an indication that, you know, there may be directional biases in certain markets based on interest rate differentials. You know, so there's some opportunities there, and there's opportunities across yield curves. There's opportunities across the entire price curve of commodities, whether in backwardation or contango, you know, that can yield directional opportunities, you know, based on the differences between contract months or specific market prices.
Sure. And the final one, alpha hedge strategy.
So alpha hedge are momentum strategies. A lot of people would refer to them as trend following. We don't, for one specific reason. For us, alpha hedge is it's an integral part of the portfolio that allows us to do a lot of the things we do in the portfolio that are non-directionally triggered. So if we end up with a fundamental strategy that's long nat gas, for example, and the nat gas market just continues to sell off, well, the alpha hedge strategies will be short.
Sure.
And they'll be offsetting that risk. And as long as each individual strategy has its own relevant return driver and a positive return expectancy over a long time, and I'm talking decades, then we feel comfortable including those in portfolio. In the short term, though, you have periods where you may just be fundamentally off on a direction in a market. The alpha hedge will never be off on a directional trend.
Sure.
It'll always be in the direction of the trend. Now what's interesting, and this is goes back to a lot of talk I hear about trend followers having a difficult period and, you know, underperforming and losing money over the last few years, and maybe that has to do with quantitative easing or a number of things. Our alpha hedge strategies have been profitable since we started trading in July of 2011. If we did nothing but trade trend following, essentially, we'd have a nice positive return going. It's been enhanced from the other strategies in the portfolio, which is the whole intent of broad strategy diversification. But that's why I look at the performance of the industry over the last few years and sort of the explanations of why the industry hasn't performed as well as it did in, you know, the prior couple decades. And to me, it has less to do with the environment and probably more to do with how people have fine-tuned their strategies to have optimized on the past data rather than allowing them to be pure and raw and sometimes poor performers over, you know, future periods. So it looks to me like a lot of the industry's probably just gotten a little too fine-tuned and curve fit on the past data, and then going into this period ended up with negative performance.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I mean, I think certainly from my view, I do think the trends are a little bit different in the last few years. I do think they're a bit shorter. I do think that they're a bit more erratic, and I do think that the manipulation or government intervention has, you know, had its influence. I think it's great that your trend following strategies essentially are immune to this and continues to perform. But I certainly from where I sit, I do think it's a bit different to what we saw prior to 2008. But I think more importantly on that subject, just to give my own view here, I think that a big part of whether you made money or whether you didn't make money in the last few years has really been the sector weights. Because if you're a fully diversified manager, there has been quite a lot of the sectors that really hasn't, you know, given you that many good opportunities, whilst there's been one or two sectors, namely the equity markets and the bonds, that where, you know, the good action has been. So, I mean, I do think that there is, you know, some influence being in terms of, you know, how diversified some of these managers, because of course some managers have done well in the last few years. But, you know, when I see the names and I think about what I believe they do, I think they are pretty heavily exposed in fixed income and equities. But that's just my view, again, sitting from the outside.
Right. Yeah, well, maybe. I mean, it's definitely things are different. They're always different. And I guess the question is, are they differently different? And so I look at, you know, our performance in momentum-based strategies, and our portfolio, our whole philosophy is to maintain balance across the portfolio, across the strategies and the markets. You know, so we've got 120, 130 markets that we're trading in. Some of those, and some of our alpha hedge strategies have lost money consistently over the last 3 years. But as a group, you know, as a strategy type, they've made money, and they've done it in a reasonably diversified fashion. They've made some money in the currencies, they made some money in interest rates and stock index, as you point out. Yeah. But they've made some. I mean, there's been some great trends in the metals.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, gold had great trend up and great trend down during that period. Some of the agriculture markets have had just tremendous trends. Yeah. You know, that trend followers could have captured had they been, you know, first, I guess, balanced across all those sectors and not dominating, you know, one sector or another. And had they had, I guess, a very, not fine-tuned, but very broad sort of parameter structure that they were using, so that they weren't fine-tuned to the specific types of trends that we had maybe in the prior few years.
Yeah. I mean, but I think the other thing maybe to just add to that, and that is in terms of these trend following strategies that you have in Alpha Hedge. I mean, my guess is that you might also be more on the longer term side compared to you know, many CTAs whom, you know, probably are more in the what we would call the medium term in terms of you know, how the models work. Because I do believe, certainly, I mean, in the long run, I think, you know, long term trend following is probably more profitable than medium-term trend following. The problem is that, you know, it also comes with a certain level of volatility and drawdown that many investors don't really like, and therefore the pure trend followers have sort of shied away from being too long-term, even though they know that that's probably the right thing to do. But so I would guess that you probably trade your alpha strategies a little bit more on the longer-term side. I don't know whether that's a correct observation or not.
Well, it's actually a really real mix. I mean, we do have some that trade with holding periods that would be, say, a losing trade that's many months, and a winning trade that could be a year or more. But we also have rather short term.
Okay.
You know, that are, you know, a winning trade might be 2 months long. You know, it's for trend following, which is, you know, pretty short term. I think a lot of the problem does get to the fact that people don't like to trade, as you pointed out, which is, I think, a great comment, that people don't like to trade some of the more difficult strategies to trade. And I think one of the things that's helped make trend following traders successful over the last few decades is that it's not an easy strategy to trade. You know, so you've got to sit there and, you know, ride through multiple years sometimes of just terrible performance, and then wait for that quarter where it all comes back and you make money. I think by maybe trying to just focus on trend following and smoothing returns within that style of trading, people have started curve fitting their strategies a little too much on the past data to make it look like they had solved the problem.
Sure.
When in reality, all they did was lower their predictability of performance.
Yeah.
You know, that there's nothing worse than doing that, because then going forward, you don't know what you're going to get.
Thanks for listening to Top Traders Unplugged. If you feel you learned something of value from today's episode, the best way to stay updated is to go on over to iTunes and subscribe to the show, so that you'll be sure to get all the new episodes as they're released. We have some amazing guests lined up for you, and to ensure our show continues to grow, please leave us an honest rating and review in iTunes. It only takes a minute, and it's the best way to show us you love the podcast. We'll see you next time on Top Traders Unplugged.